So today I'm going to discuss forward and backward linkages of financial inclusion and fintech. Will fintech cause damage to the banks and banking sector? Okay. So fintech is the most important element, you know, contributing towards financial inclusion. Financial inclusion is the goal set by the all the national governments as well as United Nations also. So that United Nations Sustainable Development Goals, there are three goals associated with this financial inclusion. So the government feels that the people should be included in the financial system of the countries. Then only if the people aware about the financial system or financial understanding, that will be important factor for the sustainability. Okay, there are many factors associated with the sustainability. You know, the climate, you know, the the disciplines of the people, etc., etc. But the financial understanding is the core factor which determine the sustainability. So financial inclusion, World Bank 2014 financial inclusion means the proportion of households and companies that use financial services. So you can imagine that the people, the volume of people who are using the financial services or household means means the family is a bigger concept than the household consists of husband and wife and kids. It's very different from the family setup. So the proportion of households and companies that use the financial services, it is quite a paradox that in the globalized world, more than one third of its population is excluded from the formal financial system. So you can imagine that one third of the world population is excluded from the formal financial system. So that is the present status. It was studied 2018, but the status has been improved right now. Hope that. So unmet need for the credit of millions of formal and informal micro, small, medium sized enterprises in developing economies amounts to about 40% of GDP. So there are micro, small, medium enterprises. They need finance, but the government and the other bodies are not able to finance these ventures, even though these ventures are economically feasible. So greater access to the financial system increases savings, reduces the income inequality, poverty, improves the employment levels, and it favors educational development also. So you know, financial awareness help, financial understanding help to improve the savings of the people. You can imagine situation that you know something about the financial literacy. The ordinary literacy is different from the financial literacy. Here we are looking for the financial literacy. So financial literacy is very helpful for the promotion of savings, and it reduces the income inequality, it reduces the poverty, it improves the employment levels, and it favors educational development also. So international level, financial education is widely recognized as a valuable tool to reduce social exclusion. So now the financial education is widely recognized as a valuable tool to reduce social exclusion. So financial inclusion, this slide explained about the importance of financial inclusion. So there are significance of financial understanding. You know, financial understanding enables people to manage their savings in a rational way. But we have to apply the financial understanding towards the financial product. So your class consists of 30 students. If 30 students, out of the 30 students or not, some 4 or 5% doing some kind of investment is a value addition of the course. You know, they will be experienced with that investment. So lack of financial education increases financial fraud, excessive and unreasonable commissions, excessive risk in financial operations, etc. So lack of financial education increases financial fraud. Excessive, like, you know, something like traditional homemade chitty funds, etc. There are a lot of cases they were corrupted and they used the funds of the ordinary people, and it was like financial scandals and scams. That could be avoided with the financial education. The World Bank, in support of financial inclusion as an effective solution for poverty reduction in the developing and underdeveloped countries. So now we can understand. Now we can understand the change in the research direction of financial inclusion. So new research trends in financial inclusion are focusing on fintech, digital finance, the financial services provided through mobile phones, cards, internet-based payments. So you know my title of the presentation. You know, it's apart from the forward and backward linkages of financial inclusion and fintech. Will fintech cause damage to the banks and banking sector? So now the fintech era, the fintech, you know, fintech products are increasing day by day. So these fintech, are these fintech kill the banks or the banking sector, etc. So we can look on that way also. So what will be the future of commercial banks after 5 or 10 years? So as we explained that the research trends of financial inclusion now directed towards the fintech. So this digital access enabled earlier the excluded people into the formal financial system of the country. The digital financial inclusion depends on the key components such as digital transaction platform, retail agents and mobile phone, and the connectivity of the people. So now the financial system targets for the connectivity, mobile phone means smartphone access, and there are some agencies who are providing the services digitally, and you know, these platform, this infrastructure is very important for the digital financial inclusion. The combination of these components is highly effective for the financial inclusion on a global scale. So emerging research trends, we can see that the emerging financial inclusion literature, the attempt to proffer solution to achieve sustainable financial inclusion, particularly in the poor economies. The financial inclusion and technology both work together to reach the sustainable development goals set SDG 8.10. So the fintech lead financial inclusion. Now the major beneficiaries of the fourth industrial revolution is fintech. So fintech is the outcome of the fourth industrial revolution. So fintech support ecosystem is essential to exploit the true potential of fintech. In fintech, you know, India is a developing country, but we haven't experienced the full potential of the fintech because of the lack of regulatory support. In India, SEBI and RBI are the regulatory bodies. They haven't given the banking license to these fintech companies, and also they are not supporting the entire activities of the fintech. Means some of the fintech companies have given the proposal, but these regulatory authorities not yet supported the full potential of the fintech companies, so that there is a stagnant move of these fintech companies in India, Indian continent. So fintech is touted as the game-changing disruptive innovation capable of shaking up traditional financial market. So you can imagine, I think you have studied a paper called Banker and Customer Relationship. So now this, the banker and customer relationship, the entire curriculum has to be changed. So now there is the old relationship with the banker and customer is not existing right now. So now there is a digital banking parallelly going on. The traditional banking has been replaced by the digital banking. So digital banking means the banks are using the artificial intelligence, etc., big data analysis, etc., machine learning, etc. So these tools change the relationship between the banker and the customer. So rise of fintech has introduced digital transformation of the brick and mortar banking model and dramatically changed the way financial services are delivered. Now there is a change in the delivery of financial services. So scope of fintech. So fintech may be understood as this use of innovative information and automation technology in financial services. New digital technologies automate a wide range of financial activities and may provide new and more cost-effective products in part of the financial sector, ranging from lending to asset management and from portfolio advice to the payment system. So an old bank was concentrated on the lending. Now this lending changed to asset management and from portfolio advice to the payment system. So with the generation of new business models based on the use of big data, fintech has potential to disrupt established financial intermediaries and the banks in particular. So that there is a danger to the banks in the future that the fintech disrupt the financial intermediaries and banking in particular. But the RBI is vigilant on this disruption of the traditional commercial banking system in India, so that the RBI haven't given the banking license to the fintech companies. You know, some of the fintech giants like Google and Amazon, they have already applied for the banking license, but RBI was reluctant to give the banking license to these multinational giants. So big data can be treated with algorithms from artificial intelligence profiting from advanced computing power, including cloud computing, mobile storage through the cloud and mobile hardware, which allows continuous accessibility to the bank. Like, you know, the old time, the bank holidays, we cannot undertake the banking transactions. Now we can transfer the money through Google Pay and all 24 hours, 364 days. It's possible. So the system was changed. And you know, there is a concept called M-money. In M-money, you can transfer or you can transact financial transactions without the help of a bank account. So M-money is a different from the mobile banking. So it's not mobile banking, it's M-money. In mobile banking, the customers access their bank accounts through their phones. M-money means the customer transact only through mobile network operators and not required an account with a financial institution or a bank. So you remember that for the transaction of M-money, it is not required to require an account with a financial institution or a bank. So that even people can transact, even people can financially transact without the help of a bank account or without a bank account. So M-money can increase the speed and reduce the cost of payments. So it enhances the security by reducing the transport of cash, increase the transparency through digital accounting and reduce the corruption. So it has been studied 2018. So M-money, the security, it enhances the security by reducing the transport of cash, increase the transparency through digital accounting and reduce the corruption. Okay, fintech is a path towards sustainability. So the UN strongly believes that fintech is a path towards sustainability. So global fintech investment, you know, $135.7 billion. So policymakers and regulators view fintech as opportunity to make the financial system more efficient, effective and resilient. So fintech innovations promise to provide the poor access to financial services such as payments, savings, credit and insurance. You know, some of the countries, some of the even underdeveloped countries, they were success by using the fintech towards the financial sustainability as well as financial inclusion. Like, you know, many countries, Kenya, etc., like and South Africa. So they have used the fintech for the financial sustainability. Of course, China. China was very successful in terms of this usage of fintech. So SDG indicators, the global indicators framework for the sustainable development goals was developed by the interagency and expert group on SDG indicators at the 48th session of the UN Statistical Commission held in March 2017. So you can see the website, sustainable development goals indicators in the UN website. And there is a separate website was opened for the sustainable development goals indicators. It was established by UN Statistical Commission held in March 2017. According to the resolution passed in the 2017, the indicator framework will be refined annually. So SDG 8, you know, SDG 8 promote sustainable, inclusive, sustainable economic growth, full productive employment and decent work for all. So this is a global sustainable development goal which was passed in 2017. So this 8 has been divided into different categories. The target 8.10 is strengthen the capacity of domestic financial institutions to encourage and expand access to banking, insurance and financial services. So this is closely linked with the finance, strengthen the capacity of domestic financial institutions to encourage and expand access to banking, insurance and financial services for all. So SDG specific 8.10.1, you know, the goal should be achieved before 2030. Number of commercial bank branches and ATMs per 1 lakh adults. That's 8.10.1. 8.10.2, proportion of adults 15 years and older with an account at a bank or other financial institution or with a mobile money service provider. So this is, opening an account is now not compulsory. In earlier time, you know, 95 to 2005, financial inclusion means the people should have a bank account so that Indian government has started a plan, Pradhan Mantri Jan Dhan Yojana. So, you know, all people should have a bank account. So this plan, based on that scenario, has been changed now. Now, you know, mobile money service provider is fine. Okay. So apart from bank account. So that mobile money service provider is an option rather than to start a bank account. That is the main agenda of the UN right now, means the promotion of sustainable financial sustainability and financial inclusion through fintech. So there are research questions whether the fintech positively influence the growth of financial inclusion. This linkage between the fintech and financial inclusion influence the sustainable development goals. Whether fintech acting as a strong pillar for sustainability. What are the key determinants of sustainable development goals 8.10? So you can do research on this area. These are the fine research questions in this area. Challenges of fintech. So there are a lot of challenges faced by the fintech. You know, digital technology has helped several low income countries to improve their financial inclusion, but this improvement does not spill over to other low income countries in the region. You know, many countries has take the advantage of the fintech era, but some of the underdeveloped countries or low income countries not yet reached the advantages of the fintech. The spillover effect is not spread towards the other low income countries. So customers are still hesitant to adopt and use fintech, which ultimately affect its growth. You know, you can see many people, they are reluctant to use Google Pay and Amazon Pay. They will give only liquid cash, even though they have a smartphone and they have the capacity to utilize this particular facility, but they will not use it. This because of the bias of the people. This bias we cannot control. So that people has to change and they have to, use these platforms. Then only the population, the volume will be increased. To achieve the sustainable development and growth of fintech, an in-depth investigation of fintech continuance intention is required. Means this continuation is very important, whether the system is going to continue or not. So the digital transformation of the society is introducing new fintech payments, fund transfer and other financial transactions. So criminals are using and abusing financial technologies for fraud, extortion, money laundering, financial activity in the criminal background. You know, many criminal acts are going in connection with this fintech, so that the RBI was reluctant to give the license to these fintech companies for starting up of bank accounts and all. So okay, so that's the main problem the challenges faced by the fintech. So, challenges to the banks due to fintech. Hypothesis that growth of financial technology negatively influences bank performance. There was a study which was happened in 2020, and it says that hypothesis that growth of financial technology negatively influences the bank performance. Now you can see the recruitments of bank, the recruitments of the in the banks has reduced, and the recruitments in the fintech was increased. So the fintech companies need more people rather than the banks. So the technology is driving the recruitment. So there is a change scenario in terms of the recruitments. So fintech competitors are encroaching on the traditional business of banks, despite the fact that banks are adapting to the digital world. Even though the banks are adapting towards the digital world, but these fintech competitors are encroaching on the traditional business of the bank. Some of the traditional business of the banks have already closed, and some of the business owned by the banks, now the majority business have taken over by the fintech companies. So new competitors are able to use hard codifiable information to erode the traditional relationship between the banker and customer. So I already explained that the traditional relationship between the banker and customer is changed. So fintech competitors are putting pressure on the traditional business model of banks. So there is a new model emerging, and the people will try to use it. Then, you know, the traditional models will be like obsolescent. So the banks are in trouble. So after that, the fintech competitors are putting pressure on traditional business model of banks. So disruptions in the financial service sector. So we are in the financial service, but there is a great disruption in financial service due to the emergence of fintech. So true disruption may come from the full-scale entry of top digital internet companies. Indeed, companies such as Amazon, Apple, or Google are already active in fintech, but have not entered the market in a resolute way because of the pressure from the regulators. So their potential is very large, however, because they have access to massive amounts of customer data, and they may control the interface with them when it comes to financial service. So regulation of fintech. So first of all, let us note that digital technologies can also be applied to solve regulatory and compliance requirements more efficiently. This is known as RegTech. So the challenge for regulation is how to keep a level playing field between incumbents and new entrants so that innovation is promoted and financial stability is preserved. So new fintech entrants should not become the new shadow banking outside the regulatory perimeter that contributed so decisively to the 2007-9 financial crisis by hiding systematic risk. So the RBI and SEBI in 2007-9 crisis, which was happened in USA, but there is a coupling effect to the Indian financial system also. But we haven't troubled because the strength of our public sector banking system. So that public sector, the importance of the public sector banking system was significant. During the time of crisis, India was totally in resistance, and India was resisted in a well manner of the financial distress or financial trouble which was happened in 2019 due to the strength of the public sector finance. So the RBI and SEBI now focusing on, even though the fintech companies are emerging, but the public sector banking, the commercial banking which is happening in India, that has to be prevailing, that system should prevail along with this fintech system. So the RBI planning to move the both systems should be taken into be active in the country. So that's why there is a resistance, there is a reluctancy by the regulators towards these fintech companies. Solution making. Financial Stability Board 2017 is the enhanced prospect for systematic problems arising out of operational risk and cyber risk with fintech activities. However, fintech startups may be able to work with less leverage than traditional banks. Okay, that's all my presentation. You can ask questions.